Right, beta. So now what we are going to do is we are going to discuss about all the abnormalities in this particular way so that it would be easy to understand for us and it would give you a quick nice impact also. Okay, so herein, if you take a look at the esophageal atresia, now in this esophageal atresia, what is happening? There is a traffic jam situation here. Why? Because during intrauterine life, there is a septum between the trachea and the esophagus. If this septum is not properly formed, sometimes what happens? This septum, it starts deviating posteriorly. And that is why the two ends of the esophagus are not able to fuse. Now, what is going to happen in this baby? Not only this esophageal atresia presents like this, but actually, in this esophageal atresia, there are some other congenital anomalies also, like vectoral, vertebral, anorectal, cardiac, tracheoesophageal fistula, renal, and the limb defects, right? So these can be the problems in this esophageal atresia baby. Now, how this baby can present during intrauterine life? Since there is a traffic jam here, as you can see, so what is going to happen? All the salivary secretions, they'll be trapped here and the baby will be throwing all the saliva out from the mouth. So MCQ people keep on asking, what is the problem in the mother? It is polyhydramnios, right? Now, when the baby is born, obviously there is a traffic jam here, so all the secretions will be coming out from the baby's mouth. There will be continuous pouring of saliva from the baby's mouth, and this will happen right at birth. Okay, the MCQ people can give you a clinical situation. Ki doctor, you are posted in the labor room, and there in the labor room you are finding that a baby is throwing the saliva out from the mouth. Okay, so you should immediately start thinking that this can be esophageal atresia. Now, what you can do there, you know that these secretions can go into the trachea, and that can be associated with pulmonary complications, right? So this has to be dealt on an urgent basis. How you will proceed? You can simply put a nasogastric tube. Now, this question was asked recently in the FNJ exam. What is the initial test for evaluation? Right, so initial test for evaluation would be passage of nasogastric tube, and this nasogastric tube is not going to go into the stomach, so this is going to get coiled in the upper esophagus. Now, you know there can be different types of esophageal atresias, but the most common type will be when the upper esophagus is blind and the lower is communicating with the trachea, that is a tracheoesophageal fistula. What you will find on a x-ray in this baby. Now herein, if you carefully take a look, what you're finding here, you're finding that the nasogastric tube has coiled in the upper esophagus. So this can be a MCQ in your exam, that what is the initial test for evaluation? It is the nasogastric tube which gets coiled here in the upper esophagus. Second, what you are seeing here is the stomach. Now, in case of esophageal atresia, ideally, if there is no connection of the upper esophagus with the lower esophagus, then no air should be going into the stomach and the stomach should be collapsed. But you know that the most common type of esophageal atresia is something like this, when the lower esophagus is communicating with the trachea, right? So what is going to happen? The tracheal air is going to go into this esophagus, so the stomach, in such cases, it will not be collapsed, but it will be distended. As you can see here, the stomach is distended with gas, right? So that is what is important on x-ray. In last year, they asked the initial test for evaluation. This time, we do not expect, but still, we should know that this x-ray can be given in your exam. And herein you have to notice there is a coiling of the nasogastric tube in the upper esophagus. plus the stomach is distended, right? Okay, now how you have to manage these patients? In the management, basically what we have to do is we have to join the two ends. We have to join the upper esophagus with the lower esophagus, and obviously you will have to chop this fistula off. ये जो connection है इसको उड़ा दो, ऊपर वाले esophagus को नीचे वाले से जोड़ दो. This operation is division of fistula and connection of the upper with the lower esophagus, that is esophagostomy, right? And this is done within 1 to 2 days of life, and the story becomes normal. Rarely, if there is a big gap between the upper and lower esophagus, then we wait for 4 to 6 weeks, allow the two ends to grow, reassess. If they regrow, then you can do the connection. But if the upper esophagus is far and the lower esophagus is quite low down, then you do a esophageal reconstruction. And for that, you can take the help of stomach. You can even take the help of colon. You can even take the help of jejunum. So that is how esophageal atresia is managed. Right, beta? So all the story of esophageal atresia is clear. Now, another MCQ, which has not been asked in the last 1 year, but it is quite commonly asked in our exams. Now, here in this picture, what you are seeing is, you are seeing that this is the esophagus. This tube, what you are seeing, beta, this is the esophagus. Now, sometimes what can happen, a right subclavian artery can be aberrant, and this aberrant right subclavian artery can press the esophagus. This deformity, when the aberrant right subclavian artery presses onto the esophagus, will cause dysphagia, and this is called as dysphagia leucoria. Isko kya bolte beta? This is called as dysphagia leucoria. Dysphagia leucoria, right? This is important for the MCQ. Single liner hai, chota sa hai, isme galti nahi karna hai, okay? Dysphagia due to compression of the esophagus by aberrant right subclavian artery is dysphagia leucoria. On my this side, you can see this is a barium swallow picture. Now, in this barium swallow picture, you can see that this area is compressed, right? That is probably because abnormal artery is pressing in this area. That is why you are not seeing the barium going in a uniform fashion. Again, you can have a look at this picture, beta. You can appreciate that how the esophagus has got narrowed. This is because of compression by a aberrant right subclavian artery. So this is dysphagia leucoria. Now we move on to the esophageal trauma section. And in esophageal trauma, the foreign bodies. We know the different foreign bodies. The commonest foreign body in a child is a coin. In an adult, it is food, like the fish bone. And in case of elderly person, it is generally the elderly people mein kya hota hai? Loose teeth or dentures. Now, what is the narrowest part where these foreign bodies can get impacted? So you know the tightest area here is the cricopharynx. So MCQ people, commonest site of impaction of foreign bodies, cricopharynx, right? Now, two different type of MCQs can be given here. Just have a look at the different foreign bodies, as they can be asked as an image-based question like this. Like here in this particular picture, you are seeing that how a coin is getting impacted at the cricopharynx, right? And here in this picture, you can see there is an open safety pin lying inside the esophagus. And this is probably a necklace which is lying inside the esophagus. Now, depending on the situation, many a times what happens, this foreign body goes inside, negotiate the cricopharynx, and it goes down into the stomach. Okay? So if the coin is lying in the stomach, this is not going to create any issues majority of the time. It is going to pass spontaneously out. So no active intervention has to be done in asymptomatic foreign bodies. But if this gets impacted here and it starts pressing on the trachea anteriorly, esophagus kaha hai? Posterior mediastinum. So if there is a foreign body which is pressing on the trachea, then the baby will be presenting with choking sensation. In this situation, what we have to do is, we have to pass a endoscope. and remove that foreign body. Okay, so immediate endoscopic removal has to be the answer in case of emergency choking type of situations. We can also try doing a Hemlich's maneuver, wherein we press the lower sternum and that is how the foreign body can come out. But generally the recommendations are that we should do an endoscopy something like this, and through this endoscopy, as you can see, this is an esophagogastroduodenoscopy, what we call it. This is what you see inside. This is the normal esophageal mucosa, what you can see. And we can pass various instruments, like you are seeing in this picture. You can pass a biopsy forceps and you can take these foreign bodies out, right? This is another picture showing different type of foreign bodies inside the esophagus. Like here in this particular picture, you are seeing a coin type of thin line. Here in this particular picture, you are seeing a toothbrush inside. Here in this picture, you are seeing a battery inside. And here you are seeing a tablet which has been swollen, ingested by the patient without removing the wrapper. So in these cases, you are just going to do a endoscopy and you will be taking these foreign bodies out. This black thing what you are seeing here in this picture, this is the flexible endoscope. Ye jo kala dikhai de raha na beta, this is the flexible endoscope, okay? And this is esophagogastroduodenoscopy. The upper GI endoscopy is esophagogastroduodenoscopy, okay? Right, now we talk about the esophageal perforations or ruptures. When we are doing this endoscopy, sometimes while passing this endoscope, we might face some resistance at the cricopharynx. And in those cases, the endoscope can go into the mediastinum. Okay, so that will cause esophageal perforation. Right, the commonest site of esophageal perforation, near the cricopharynx. The commonest cause of esophageal perforation, instrumentation, that is endoscopy. And which endoscope, beta? Rigid or flexible? Obviously, rigid will have more chances of this esophageal perforation, right, beta? Now, what should be done in the management? Generally, these iatrogenic, doctor-induced esophageal perforations, they are very small perforations and they heal spontaneously. So, no surgical intervention is generally required for iatrogenic perforations. You just leave a nasogastric tube here for 5 to 7 days and these perforations are going to close spontaneously. However, these iatrogenic perforations should be differentiated from another situation, which is a dangerous type of situation, which we call as Bohr-Harvey syndrome. This Bohr-Harvey syndrome or barotrauma, this was asked in December 2019 FMG exam, right? Now, in this case, what is going to happen generally when the stomach is full, jab koi zyada khana kha le, zyada pee le. Now, if the stomach is full because of meals or because of drinking, intragastric pressure will increase. Yahan pe pressure ka kya hoga beta? The pressure is going to increase, right? In such situation, the gastric muscles can contract forcefully. The gastric muscles can contract forcefully. And when they contract forcefully, they will throw these gastric contents out under pressure. Bahut zyada pressure hoga. And this high pressure, especially in elderly people, when the wall of the esophagus has become weak, this esophagus will not be able to tolerate such high pressure and this esophagus will rupture. Kis jagah pe rupture ho raha hai beta? If you take a look here, this is the esophagus, this is the stomach, and this rupture is taking place in the lower esophagus. Transmural, all layers are involved. So what will happen? The gastric contents will immediately rush into the mediastinum. And these gastric contents, when they rush into the mediastinum here, they will cause mediastinitis. And this can lead to septicemia also. this patient will present with left-sided chest pain, radiating to the shoulder and sometimes to the arm, mimicking acute myocardial infarction. Because the esophagus has ruptured, as you can see here, huge amount of air would also have come into the mediastinum, and this air would be lying beneath the skin, which we call as subcutaneous emphysema or surgical emphysema, which is pathognomic of Bor-Harvey syndrome, right? Apart from this, Meckler's striatum is vomiting, chest pain, and subcutaneous emphysema. Meckler's striatum is vomiting, chest pain, and subcutaneous emphysema. Right, Peter? How do we approach these patients? If the patient comes to us in emergency with left-sided chest pain radiating here and here, the first thing which comes to our mind is acute myocardial infarction. So we should not forget in these situations to rule out the cardiac event. That means the first and foremost thing what we have to do here is we have to stabilize these patients. Okay, first stabilize these patients, get the ECG done, get the cardiac enzymes done. Once the cardiac event is ruled out, then you can start focusing on this Bor-Harvey syndrome. You can do the auscultation. Since lot of air is lying here, so you will hear that kad-kad sound. That is called as mediastinal crunch or Hammond's crunch or Hammond's sign, right? Just like the footsteps in the snow. You can get the X-ray done. On X-ray, you will see huge amount of air free in the mediastinum. That is called as pneumomediastinum. X-ray mein kya dikh raha hai? Pneumomediastinum. But the best thing what you can do here is a CT scan with oral contrast. But when we are giving the oral contrast, like in this particular picture, if you ask the patient to swallow the contrast is going down. But if there is rupture of the esophagus here, then this contrast is going to leak into the mediastinum, right? So the type of contrast which we are using in GI perforations, I repeat, the type of contrast which we are using in GI perforations, that has to be very important. Barium should not be used because barium is hypertonic, right? And if the barium leaks out here, it can cause injury to these mediastinal structures. Okay? So instead of using barium, whenever there is a GI perforation, we prefer using gastrographin. Okay? The best thing what we can do is a CT scan with oral contrast, and that will determine the exact site of the esophageal rupture. Now, how to manage these patients? Once we have made the diagnosis, there is septicemia here, and we know if we have to treat septicemic patients, we have to reduce the septic load. Since there is a high septic load and patient can die because of this septic load, you as a doctor will do a thoracotomy, will go inside, do a nice thoracic lavage. That thoracic lavage will reduce the septic load and will save the life of this patient. This is what you have to remember, right, Beta? Now, once the life is saved, then the second question comes, what should be done for this perforation? Whether we should close this perforation or we should leave it open. That simply depends on how much is the contamination in this area. If there is less contamination in this area, then you can close this perforation. But if there is cross contamination in this area, then this area is also grossly infected. And if you put the sutures here, they will become infected and the very purpose of closing this will be defeated. So in these situations, depending on the amount of contamination, if the contamination here is less, you can close. If the contamination is more, then you should leave this open and just put a drain tube here so that whatever leaks out from this area, that leak can be drained through the drainage tube and should not cause septicemia. This is the concept in dealing with all the GI perforations. Sare GI perforation mein, this is the concept what you are going to apply. Right, beta? Then another thing in the trauma section is a lye stricture. Now here, this barium swallow picture what you are seeing, you can appreciate that the normal esophagus is something like this. But what is happening, there is a traffic jam situation here. And because of the traffic jam here, the proximal esophagus is dilated. And because the proximal esophagus is dilated, there would be stasis of food and other complications. Now this narrowing what you are seeing here, this we call as stricture. The term lye is a specific term. The term lye is a specific term which is used for ingestion of caustics. Ingestion of caustics. Jaise ghar mein phenol rakha hai. Caustic is an alkali. So somebody, if he swallows that alkali, that is going to cause intense inflammation, healing, fibrosis, and fibrosis is going to cause the stricture. Stricture in the esophagus, which is associated with ingestion of caustic, that is what we call as the lye stricture. Okay, beta? So this is what you have to remember. This is about the esophageal trauma. Now we move from the trauma to the lower esophagus, the ecclesia cardia and the GRD. The ecclesia cardia, it is due to absence of ganglion cells in the orbic plexus. Ecclesia cardia is a situation wherein there is absence of ganglion cells in the orbic plexus in the entire esophagus. Pure ke pure esophagus mein ganglion cells nahi hai, because of which the peristalsis will not occur in the esophagus. Right, beta? Plus, there is a selective damage to the inhibitory neurons in the lower esophagus. Selective damage to the inhibitory neurons in the lower esophagus, because of which the lower esophagus area, it cannot relax. It remains contracted. And if it remains contracted, it will lead to a traffic jam type of situation. Traffic jam type of situation. Something similar to this, absence of ganglion cells, beta, is also seen somewhere else in GIT. In the rectum and sigmoid. What is that condition called as, beta? When there are absence of ganglion cells? PDA wale sir ne bhi padhaya apne ko? Hirschsprung disease or congenital megacolon or congenital aganglionosis. Now what is happening here, it can be this ecclesia what we are seeing, this can be either because of some primary reason, that is called as primary ecclesia, where the exact cause is not known. Sometimes it can be secondary to some diseases, like in diabetes. In diabetes what happens, there is a neuropathy. So the muscle weakness can be seen. The muscles will not be contracting. Chagas disease and even cancer of the esophagus, cancer growing inside the esophagus, can also cause a traffic jam situation like this, and that can also be called as ecclesia cardia. That will be a secondary ecclesia. Secondary ecclesia bolenge beta usko, okay? And there is a term called as pseudo-ecclesia, which is associated with secondary ecclesia, but pseudo means false. And this false means there is no pathology of the esophagus per se. Esophagus ki koi samasya nahi hai, but there is somebody outside the esophagus which is pressing the esophagus. So this can be a tumor here in the mediastinum, this can be a tumor here in the mediastinum, or there can be a tumor growing from this part of the stomach, which we call as cardia. So tumors of the cardia of the stomach, they can press on the lower esophagus and cause a traffic jam situation. And that is what we call as pseudo-ecclesia. Okay, so tumors around the esophagus can lead to narrowing of the esophagus. That is what is pseudo-ecclesia, right? Now, how these patients present? Generally, 25 to 40 years of age, there's a traffic jam, so the patient will not be able to swallow nicely. Dysphagia will be initially for liquids. Ideally, what should happen if this patient wants to have a rasgulla? Because of the traffic jam, the rasgulla will not be able to go down, right? But what happens, since the rasgulla, that is a solid food that has got some weight, so because of this weight, what happens, this rasgulla, when it is coming here, it relaxes the sphincter, and the sphincter opens up and the rasgulla passes down. But if the patient wants to just swallow some liquid, okay, suppose the patient just want to swallow some liquid. Now, when this liquid is coming here, liquid does not have the weight. So, liquid will not have the pressure to relax this sphincter. That is why liquid will not be able to go down and the liquid will be arrested. That is the reason why in ecclesia cardia, there is dysphagia for liquids initially. Okay, this is against the common sense, but we know the solid food will be having some weight which can relax the sphincter and the solid food can go down. But the liquid will not be having any weight, so liquid will not be able to relax the sphincter and the liquid will not be able to go down. That is what is important in ecclesia cardia. Right, beta? Great. Apart from this, there can be various complications since the food is getting impacted here. Now, this food is going to cause damage to the esophageal mucosa. There can be esophagitis in the middle part of the esophagus. There can be regurgitation of food, which can lead to aspiration, pulmonary complications. Plus, if the food stays here for a long period of time, there can be foul-smelling breath, which we call as halitosis. Plus, if suppose there is change or damage to the esophageal mucosa here, and if this damage persists for a long period of time, then it can lead to cancer. Which cancer? Yahan pe kaun si lining hai beta? What is the lining here? It is the squamous. So which cancer? Squamous cell carcinoma. Right, so this can be a complication of ecclesia cardia. Dhyan rakhna beta, ecclesia mein the site of cancer is middle esophagus and the cancer is squamous cell carcinoma. Okay, right, now how we have to approach these patients? What we can do is we can do a barium contrast study. The investigation, the first investigation which can be done is a barium swallow. What we find on barium swallow in these cases, something like this. Now, if you ask the patient to drink the contrast, what you are going to see is something like this. I hope you are able to see this nicely. This can be an image-based MCQ in your exam. Is photo ko dhyan se dekh lijiye beta, acche se dekh lijiye is photo ko. What you are seeing here, this area is the lower esophageal sphincter area which is contracted. You can see there is an abrupt tapering here, and this abrupt tapering is commonly asked in the MCQs. This abrupt tapering, what you are seeing here, this is called as the bird beak appearance or the pencil tip appearance, right? This area, what you are seeing here, where only a thin rim of contrast is flowing down, is called as rat tail appearance. Though rat tail is more precisely, more commonly seen in cancer esophagus, but it can also be seen in ecclesia cardia. Right, beta? Dubara se dekh lijiye, have a look at this picture once again. Acche se is photo ko dekh lijiye. Any of these pictures will be given to you in the exam. And they will ask you, what is this pathology? Acche se dekh lijiye, thok baja ke dekh lijiye is photo ko beta. Galti nahi karna hai yahan pe. So this is what we can find on Barium swallow, the bird beak pencil tip, rat tail, and we are not seeing nice contrast in the stomach, which we call as absence of gastric air bubble. Once we get this investigation done, then this can be related to a motility disorder in the esophagus. There are various motility disorders like nutcracker, diffuse esophageal spasm also. If we have to differentiate these different motility disorders, then we have to do a pressure study. So for that, what we can do is we can put a pressure monitor inside the esophagus, and with the help of this pressure monitor, we can assess the pressure inside the esophagus. Now, normal intraesophageal pressure is around 10 to 25 millimeter of mercury. In ecclesia cardia, this pressure increases from 25 to 100. In nutcracker, 180 to 200. Diffuse, more than 300 to 400. Right? So these can be the different pressures and different motility disorders. This pressure study, which we call as manometry, esophageal manometry, because it is able to differentiate the different motility disorders, this is considered as the standard investigation for ecclesia cardia. I hope this is absolutely clear. So two things, one is a barium study, another is esophageal manometry. This is what we are doing. In case of diffuse esophageal spasm, now this image has been asked as an image-based question in your exam very recently. This is a diffuse esophageal spasm, which we call as the nutcracker esophagus. Is photocopy acche se dekh lijiye beta. Just have a look at this picture nicely. This has been asked recently in your exam, right? So I hope you're not going to miss out onto this. This is a diffuse esophageal spasm or a cork screw esophagus. There is another problem in the esophagus before we move on to the treatment of ecclesia, and that is called as the Schatzky's ring. Now Schatzky's ring, this is a circumferential mucosal submucosal thickening seen at the squamocolumnar junction. As you can see nicely, andar jo dikhai de raha hai, this thing what you are seeing inside, this is the stomach area, and the proximal thing what you are seeing here, like here in this area, this is the esophagus. So just at the squamocolumnar junction, you can appreciate there is a ring-like thing all around. This is a mucosal submucosal circumferential thickening, which can lead to intermittent dysphagia, right? If the patient presents with intermittent dysphagia, then you can do endoscopy and just dilate this ring, endoscopic dilatation. And that is how we can treat these Schatzky's rings. Now, coming back to ecclesia cardia, what should be the treatment for this ecclesia cardia? In this case, what we want to achieve is, we want that the lower esophageal sphincter should be relaxed. We can give some medicine like calcium channel blockers, nitrates. We can use balloon dilatation. Endoscopic balloon dilatation can be done, but this carries the risk of rupture, or we can do some surgery. Like surgery, what we can do here is myotomy. Like in this particular picture, what we are doing is we are just going to make a longitudinal incision. This is a longitudinal incision cutting the lower esophageal sphincter, extending onto the cardia of the stomach. Here, since there is no serosa, so we are directly cutting the muscle, so we call it as myotomy. Something like this seen in hypertrophic pyloric stenosis, jahan pe pylorus ki hypertrophy ho jati hai. There also, in order to relax the pylorus, we have to make a longitudinal incision. But since we are cutting first the serosa there, then the muscle, so that operation in pylorus is called as seromyotomy. Esophagus mein, ecclesia mein, it is just a myotomy. But in pyloric stenosis, it is a seromyotomy. Right? Apart from this, POEM, that is per-oral endoscopic myotomy, can be done. POEM, P-O-E-M, per oral endoscopic myotomy can be done, and that is how we can treat this achalasia cardia. If we go to another pathology related to this lower esophageal sphincter, where if suppose we relax the lower esophageal sphincter, we all know what is going to happen. Like here in this particular picture, you can nicely see what is happening here on this side. If the lower esophageal sphincter is relaxed, then the gastric contents will go into the esophagus. And you know that inside the stomach, there is huge amount of acid. Khub sari aag hoti hai. So this acid is going to reflux into the esophagus. And this is going to burn the lower esophagus, esophagitis. And this pathology is called as gastroesophageal reflux disease. All of us do have the transient relaxations of this lower esophageal sphincter, which can occur for 3 to 4 times in 24 hours. Right? Dhyan dijiyega. Transient lower esophageal sphincter relaxations can occur for 3 to 4 times in 24 hours in normal individuals. But if the frequency of these increases, if the frequency of these refluxes increases, then we start calling it as disease. Right, beta? So this is what we have to understand. These relaxations, what we are seeing here, these relaxations are generally common in the head low position. If the person is lying supine, then the chances of reflux will be more. Okay? So supine means when he's sleeping, at that point of time, the refluxes would be maximum. Now, how this can turn into a disease? Kaun hai jo is lower esophageal sphincter ko barbaad karta hai? Who is destroying this lower esophageal sphincter? Smoking. Most important culprit is smoking. Apart from this, alcohol, chai, coffee, hot liquids, spicy food, some medicines like CCBs, nitrates, then obesity. If the intra-abdominal pressure is high, then obviously this pressure would be going on to the lower esophageal sphincter as well, and that can become weak. Progesterone can also cause weakness of this lower esophageal sphincter, right? Once this sphincter becomes weak, patient will start experiencing frequent refluxes of acid, and because of these frequent refluxes of acid, the patient will complain of heartburn, dil jalta hai. Is tarah se patient can come to us, heartburn, right, beta? So if the patient comes to us with the heartburn, or maybe epigastric pain, or maybe regurgitation type of thing, how we have to approach? Since we know that this lower esophageal sphincter weakness is most often linked to the lifestyle of the person. So first of all, we have to try modifying the lifestyle of the person. Stop smoking alcohol, chai, coffee, hot liquid, spicy food. Then we ask the patient ki don't lie supine immediately after meals. Generally, the food remains inside the stomach for 2 to 3, 3 to 4 hours. If suppose somebody has taken the meal and immediately after that he goes to sleep, so what is going to happen? That food, the intragastric pressure would be high. So that high pressure will force the food to come into the esophagus. That is why the standard recommendations are that you should not go to sleep within 3 to 4 hours after your meals. At least 4 hours should have been spent after meals before you lie on the bed, right? So we can advise all this to the patient. We can advise the patient that on the bed where he's sleeping, to elevate the head end of the bed by 5 to 8 inches. Elevate the head end of the bed by 5 to 8 inches, right? So these are the classical recommendations to these patients. If the patient follows your advice, then the patient is successfully treated. But if the patient does not follow your advice, he keeps on with his smoking, alcohol and all those habits, then definitely he is going to keep on having those problems, And if the acid is continuously coming, burning the lower esophagus, then you advise the patient to take some acid reducing agents. And we all know the gold standard for all acid related disorders are, kya dete hain acid kam karne ke liye? PPIs. So the gold standard for reducing the acid secretion would be PPIs, proton pump inhibitors. And once you give these PPIs to the patient, you know that what is going to happen to the acid content inside. The acid content inside is going to reduce. Agar acid kam ho gaya and then the patient is having reflux, this is not going to cause damage to the esophageal mucosa. The pH inside the stomach generally is 1.5 to 2 or 2 to 3. Inside the esophagus it is 5 to 7. But when the pH falls below 4, then the chances of damage to the esophagus are more. So we don't want that pH should be less than 4 inside the esophagus. By giving PPIs, if you reduce the acid, the pH inside will increase. And if this pH is 5 or 6, there is not going to be any damage to the esophageal mucosa. So this is how GRD patients are managed. The treatment of choice for GRD, proton pump inhibitors. No investigation has been done, nothing has been done, right? Now, if suppose the patient is not getting any relief, then you can do some investigation. Suppose patient is coming to you again and again, doctor, the medicine which you have given, I'm not getting any relief. I'm having pain here, discomfort here. Sometimes I'm having pain here in the epigastrium also. Now you start thinking, what should be done? Let us see where is the problem. So when you have to see where is the problem, you have to do a endoscopy. Investigation of choice for GRD is upper GI endoscopy, but this is done when the patient is not responding to the lifestyle modification and the PPIs. Dhyan rakhna, upper GI endoscopy straight away nahi karna hai, ekdam se nahi karna hai ki patient aaya heart band ke saath, chalo endoscope dal dein. No, nothing. First try to treat with lifestyle modification and PPIs. If the patient is not getting settled with that, then you do the endoscopy, and this is what you can see on endoscopy. Endoscopy mein hume kya dikhai de raha hai? Now here you are seeing, you're passing your endoscope into this area, and on this side what you are noticing, the red hot mucosa, the red hot inflamed mucosa. This is what you will see on upper GI endoscopy, right? So this is how esophagitis can be seen on endoscopy. But this esophagitis can be due to some other reasons also. So whether the patient is having GRD or not, you have to demonstrate whether the patient is having frequent refluxes into the esophagus or not. So the gold standard investigation to prove GRD, the gold standard investigation to prove GRD should be a 24-hour study where you can see that refluxes are quite frequent. So for that, we do a 24-hour ambulatory pH monitoring. And this ambulatory pH monitoring this is the ambulatory pH monitoring for 24 hours. There's a monitor inside the esophagus. On this axis, we have plotted the pH. You know, the normal pH in the esophagus is 5 to 7. Normal pH in the esophagus is 5 to 7. When the pH falls below 4, that is called as pathological, right? Below 4 is pathological. Now focus on this 24-hour. What you are finding in this 24-hour study is, normally the study started at say 10 a.m. in the morning, and majority of the time what you are seeing here, the refluxes are between 5 to 7 pH only. At one point of time, maybe around 6 p.m., 7 p.m., the pH has dropped below 4. But what is happening at night time, when he has gone to sleep at 12 o'clock in the night, this is 12 o'clock in the night. During sleep, you can see the frequency of these refluxes below 4 have become more than 3 to 4 times. So if the pH drops below 4 for more than 4 times in 24 hours, that is suggestive of GRD, and that is what is called as MCQ criteria, Johnson-Demeester criteria, or Johnson-Demeester score. So that is how you can prove this GRD. I repeat, investigation of choice, agar poochte hai, toh it is upper GI endoscopy. But gold standard investigation, agar poochte hai, toh it is 24-hour ambulatory pH monitoring, right? And now, since medicines are not working, you have to do some surgery to prevent this reflux. Samasya kya thi? What was the problem in GRD? The basic problem was this. Relaxation of the lower esophageal sphincter. This lower esophageal sphincter was relaxed. So surgically, you have to tighten this area. And to tighten this area, what you can do is something like this. Now here in this picture, you can see this is something normal. And here to tighten the lower esophagus, you have wrapped the fundus of the stomach all around the esophagus. 360 degree wrapping of the fundus around the esophagus. This is called as Nissen's fundoplication. Nissen's fundoplication. There can be different fundoplications like DOR, which is a partial fundoplication. There can be another fundoplication like Tupet, which is again a partial fundoplication. So this surgery is what you can do for GERD. Now, what can be the different complications of this GERD? Suppose the patient is continuously experiencing this GERD, bar reflux ho raha hai. What can happen to this lower esophagus? Herein you are seeing, if continuous acid is damaging the lower esophagus, then the lower esophageal squamous mucosa would like to protect itself because of this acid. How to protect, how stomach protects itself from this acid? God has given a mucus barrier inside the stomach. There is a coating of mucus on the surface of the stomach which prevents acid coming in contact with the stomach mucosa. So that is how our stomach is protected. The lower esophagus is continuously bearing this problem. So the lower esophagus also want to have that mucus barrier. And who forms the mucus? Very important. Who forms this mucus? Goblet cell, right? So the mucosa of the lower esophagus, which is generally the squamous, will now undergo metaplasia into columnar, wherein the columnar lining can have those goblet cells, and it will be a intestinal columnar metaplasia, because intestinal columnar lining will be having huge amount of goblet cells. So there is a intestinal columnar metaplasia of the squamous mucosa of the lower esophagus, which we call as Barrett's esophagus. That is what is Barrett's esophagus. Isko bolte hain Barrett's, right? Now, there can be different type of Barrett's. Like there can be a short segment Barrett's, there can be a long segment Barrett's, or there can be just a squamocolumnar junction involvement, right? So if the length of Barrett's is less than 3, it is short segment. If the length is more than 3, it is a long segment Barrett's. To make the diagnosis of Barrett's, what you can do is, you can do this endoscopy. What you are seeing here, you just do an endoscopy in this area. Take a biopsy from this metaplastic area, and if on biopsy the pathologist is able to tell you that goblet cells are present, that is diagnostic of Barrett's. You try to treat these patients by PPIs initially. However, if on pathology you come to know that there is a moderate to severe dysplasia, That means the risk of cancer is high. Which cancer will occur in the columnar lining? It will be adenocarcinoma. So Barrett's esophagus is going to predispose to adenocarcinoma in the lower esophagus, right? If the chances of cancer are high, then you can remove this lower esophagus. Ye niche ka esophagus nikal ke phek do and just bring the stomach and do a anastomosis. So that is how we are going to treat this Barrett's. Though there are other modalities also in the treatment, like here there is a radio frequency ablation of the Barrett's going on. So these are different modalities which can be tried. But the standard would be initially with PPIs. If the dysplasia is high, if there is a high grade dysplasia, then we do a surgical resection of the lower esophagus with a gastric pull-up operation. Most common complication of GRD, please remember, it is not the Barrett's, but it is esophagitis. Most common complication of GRD is esophagitis. Okay, esophagitis is the most common. However, if this esophagitis persists for a long period of time, then it can lead to this Barrett's. Plus, because of continuous reflux, sometimes what can happen, this stomach, the gastroesophageal junction, that can move into the thorax, right? When the stomach moves into the thorax, this is called as hiatus hernia, right? So that is how the stomach can move into the thorax, and that is what we call as hiatus hernia. When the gastroesophageal junction moves into the thorax, this is a sliding hiatus hernia. This is also one of the complications of GRD. Okay. However, at this point of time, we should also know another type of hiatus hernia, and that is called as paraesophageal, rolling, or giant. Again, a recently asked MCQ in the FMG exam, what is a giant hiatus hernia? So, beta, giant hiatus hernia is this. This is a paraesophageal hiatus hernia. In this paraesophageal, what is happening? If there is weakness of the diaphragm here, then the fundus of the stomach can go into the thorax. When the fundus of the stomach goes into the thorax, that is called as paraesophageal or giant hiatus hernia. Important to note, the gastroesophageal junction remains in the abdomen. Gastroesophageal junction remains in the abdomen in case of paraesophageal hiatus hernia. While in a sliding hiatus hernia, if you focus, the gastroesophageal junction is going towards the thorax. Right, beta? Ye cheez dhyan rakhna hai. The basic difference between sliding and paraesophageal, the gastroesophageal junction. Now, if the gastroesophageal junction goes into the thorax, it is sliding. If only the fundus of the stomach is going into the thorax, the G junction remains in the abdomen. This is called as paraesophageal hiatus hernia. I hope you can see both of them nicely. Right, beta? So herein, the G junction has gone into the thorax, while here, the G junction is in the abdomen. Only the fundus of the stomach has gone into the thorax. Okay, so this is how you are going to differentiate the sliding and the paraesophageal varieties. Right, and the treatment, basically your aim would be to bring the stomach back into the abdomen. Various investigations which can show you this hiatus hernia, like a simple investigation is a chest x-ray, which can show the stomach shadow in the thorax, just to diagnose whether the stomach is in the thorax or not. So a simple chest x-ray can show you that yes, the stomach is lying in the thorax. I hope you can see the stomach bubble nicely in the thorax, right? So this is what is a hiatus hernia. But if you want to know whether it is a sliding type or a paraesophageal type, then it is preferred to give the contrast. Now, when you are giving the contrast, the contrast can show you whether the gastroesophageal junction has gone into the thorax or it is in the abdomen. In this contrast study, the G junction has gone into the thorax. So this will be a type of sliding hiatus hernia. sliding hiatus hernia. Right, beta? The best investigation to diagnose this hiatus hernia, to differentiate this hiatus hernia, would be a CT scan with oral contrast. CT scan with oral contrast, and you will be able to see whether the GE junction is in the thorax or it is in the abdomen. Okay. Once this is done, you have to bring the stomach back into the abdomen. So you can just bring the stomach back into the abdomen and wrap the fundus of the stomach around the lower esophagus, which we call as Nissen's fundoplication. So that is how we can manage these hiatus hernias. And finally, if you take a look at another pathology inside the esophagus, which is called as cricopharyngeal ecclesia. Now, in this cricopharyngeal ecclesia, basically what we are talking about, whenever the cricopharyngeal sphincter is tight, when the cricopharyngeal sphincter is tight, the pressure in the pharynx is more. And suppose this is the area of the cricopharynx here. If this is tight, there is high pressure. If the wall of the pharynx is weak, which is usually the posterior pharyngeal wall through the Killian's dehiscence, inferior constrictor muscle, cricopharyngeus, there can be outpouching of the posterior pharyngeal wall posteriorly, which we call as Zenker's diverticulum. The other name of Zenker's is cricopharyngeal ecclesia. I hope this is absolutely clear. This is a false diverticulum because it does not contain all the layers. The congenital diverticulas like the Meckel's and the congenital bladder diverticulum, they are true diverticulas. They are true diverticulas, right? Because they are having all the layers of the organ. Now, this Zenker's diverticulum can be associated with webs in the esophagus in 50% of the cases. Sometimes this diverticulum can cause dysphagia. Now, how this diverticulum can cause dysphagia? If you take a look at some more pictures of Zenker's diverticulum, herein, again, the same story has been demonstrated that how the pharyngeal wall has outpouched. Now, if you focus on this particular picture, this is the outpouching here. What can happen if you focus only in this area? When the patient is taking food, suppose he is taking a rasgulla. Now, what will happen to the rasgulla? The rasgulla was supposed to go like this in the esophagus. But if the rasgulla comes into the diverticula is full of the rasgulla. And this is going to press on the esophagus anteriorly. If the esophagus is pressed, then what is going to happen? Patient will not be able to eat another rasgulla. So this will lead to dysphagia. Right? Plus, if the rasgulla remains here for a long period of time, it will create a foul smell and there will be foul smelling breath, halitosis. So these can be the presentations. Clinically, if we try to press the swelling, then we can reduce this swelling, which produces a gurgling sound, which is called as the Boyer's sign. Sometimes what can happen, there can be regurgitation of this dirty food into the trachea, which can lead to aspiration and pulmonary complications. So the commonest complication of Zenker's is a pulmonary abscess, right? How to diagnose these cases? Best investigation what you can do is this. That is again the barium swell. Please have a look at this picture carefully. This can be asked as an image-based MCQ. Achche se dekh lijiye isko. As you can see here, you can nicely appreciate there is an outpouching. And this is what is Zenker's diverticulum. Pehchan loge beta isko aram se exam mein. I hope you will be able to identify this nicely. There are more pictures for this Zenker's barium swallow. This is one. Another picture, something like this. Like herein also, you can appreciate there's an outpouching like this. So this is also a Zenker's diverticulum. In the treatment, what we can do, depending on the size of the diverticula, if it is less than 2 centimeter, we can simply do a cricopharyngeal myotomy as we were doing in case of achalasia cardia. Achalasia mein myotomy kahan ki ho rahi thi? Lower esophagus ki. Zenker's mein kahan ki myotomy ho rahi hai? Cricopharyngeal. Cricopharyngeal sphincter myotomy can be done for small diverticulas. For 2 to 4 centimeter diverticulas, we can do a diverticulopexy. And for bigger size diverticulas, we can do this Dolman's operation, which is a linear stapler operation. We pass a linear stapler and we fire the stapler in such a way so that we just connect the diverticula. We just divide the septum between the diverticula and the esophagus so that the diverticula is actually connected with the esophagus. The food will not stay inside. The food will directly go into the esophagus. That is called as diverticuloesophagostomy. Diverticuloesophagostomy or Dolman's operation. So this is what we can do for Zenker's. Now the final last topic in the esophagus, that is about the esophageal cancer. This esophageal cancer, most commonly it is seen in the upper two-third, where middle one-third is the most common. And you know the lining here is squamous. So the commonest malignancy in the esophagus is a squamous cell carcinoma. However, in Western countries, because of reflux, GRD, the chances of cancer in the lower esophagus are more. And this GRD associated esophageal cancer is secondary to Barrett's, that is adenocarcinoma. So in the esophagus broadly, the commonest malignancy is squamous, which is found in the upper two-third, and in the upper two-third it is the middle esophagus. But in Western countries, due to GRD, it is the adenocarcinoma in the lower esophagus. There can be various risk factors implicated for this esophageal cancer. Various risk factors which can cause esophageal cancer, they include smoking, alcohol, then the dietary habits. A person who is consuming huge amount of those gutkha and all, the liquid of that gutkha can go into the esophagus and can harm the esophagus. Apart from this, there can be GRD for the lower esophagus, achalasia cardia for the middle esophagus, Zenker's diverticulum for the upper esophagus. Rarely there can be human papilloma virus infection. Radiation can cause damage here. Tylosis palmaris and tylosis plantaris, these can be associated with esophageal cancer. And do not forget the very, very important syndrome for esophageal cancer, and that is Plummer-Vinson syndrome, called as Patterson-Brown-Kelly syndrome or syndropenic dysphagia. I repeat, very important syndrome for esophageal cancer. It is Patterson-Brown-Kelly syndrome, Plummer-Vinson syndrome or syndropenic dysphagia. This comprises of iron deficiency anemia, glossitis and esophageal webs. Esophageal webs are seen in post-cricoid region, post-cricoid. And these are common in middle-aged females. Post cricoid kaun sa cancer hoga yahan pe? Squamous hoga ki adeno hoga? What cancer here? This is the upper esophagus, beta. So I will not tell you which cancer. Okay, you know it, right, beta? So this is important related to risk factors for esophageal cancer. How the cancer can grow? Here is the commonest type of esophageal cancer, and this is a polyp type of growth, polypoidal growth inside the esophagus, right? So this is a polypoidal esophageal cancer, right? This is having the best prognosis also. How this cancer will grow? Another type is a ulcerative type, fungating type. Fungating will be having the worst prognosis. polypoidal will be having the best prognosis. As you can see, it is a polyp growing into the esophagus. If this polyp is small, it is not going to cause any problems. Early stage of esophageal cancer will be asymptomatic. Esophageal cancer more commonly seen in males after 60-70 years of age. Initial stages, no problems. But when the polyp starts occupying more than 2/3 lumen of the esophagus, then the patient will start experiencing dysphagia. Jab ye polyp bada ho jayega, it will start occupying more than 2/3 lumen of the esophagus, then the patient will present with dysphagia. Now, if this polyp goes into the deeper layers, right, it can even involve the nerves near this esophagus, and hoarseness of voice can be due to involvement of MCQ, recurrent laryngeal nerve. Anorexia, weight loss, hoarseness is due to recurrent laryngeal nerve involvement. How you will approach this patient? 70-year-old gentleman coming to you with dysphagia. You can do a barium swallow. If you do a barium swallow, this is what you can find on barium swallow. What is this? The classical rat tail appearance. How this rat tail appearance is seen? Herein, just try to focus on this. There is a cancer in this area, and because of the cancer here in this area, only a thin rim of contrast is flowing from the side of the cancer, which is appearing as a rat tail. And because there is a cancer here, there would be some traffic jam. The proximal esophagus is slightly dilated, just like the body of the rat. And here that thin rim of contrast is what is a rat tail appearance. Another very important thing which you should not forget is a filling defect. Now this here in this picture, you can see a filling defect in the esophagus. This is the normal esophagus, suppose. Herein you are seeing a narrowing. Probably in this area is the cancer. The contrast will not go into the cancer tissue. So the cancer tissue will not be seen on this contrast study, which we call as filling defect. Filling defect is suggestive of some mechanical obstruction, some mass, some growth, or if we are talking about biliary urinary tract, the stones, they also, the contrast will not go inside. So they will also appear as filling defects. Important for the MCQs, the catchy point in the MCQ, filling defect, elderly person. Right? Okay. Apart from this, sometimes we can find this apple core appearance also in esophageal cancer, but it is classically seen in colon cancer. Can you appreciate this apple core here? Aisa lag raha hai kisi ne apple kha ke chhod diya hai. On all the sides, on this side as well as on this side, this is the cancerous area. This is the cancerous area, and the contrast is flowing as a thin rim in the center of the cancer. So this is giving an apple core appearance, but this is more often seen in colon cancer. It can be seen in esophageal cancer. So basically, in this 70-year-old gentleman, what you have done is, patient presented with dysphagia, you have done a barium swallow, rat tail, filling defect, apple core, all this can be seen. You are suspecting there's a traffic jam somewhere, and probably it's a case of cancer. So why to wait? Go for that MCQ. Go for the investigation of choice for esophageal cancer, and that is upper GI endoscopy and biopsy. So what you can do here is, you can just do a upper GI endoscopy, and like you are seeing in this particular picture, this is the normal esophageal mucosa here, and this is the cancerous tissue here. You can just take a tukda of this, you can just take a tissue from this, and the biopsy will tell you that yes, this is a cancer. Whether it is a squamous or adeno, that can also be known on biopsy. Before you jump onto the treatment of malignancies, it is important to know how far the cancer has spread. To know the cancer has spread, if you want to know this local area, the best thing would be a CECT of the abdomen. But if you just want to know the depth, how many layers are getting involved, we can do endoscopic ultrasound. Like this picture for endoscopic ultrasound, you can pass this endoscopic ultrasound and you will be able to see the different layers. The mucosa, the submucosa, the muscularis layer. And this is how you will come to know what are the different layers of esophagus involved by this cancer. But for staging purpose, for local staging, you can do a CECT of the thorax. And if the cancer in the lower esophagus, obviously CECT of the abdomen as well. To know about the distant metastasis, we have got a wonderful golden investigation for distant metastasis, and that is this. This is PET scan, positron emission tomography. This is positron emission tomography. The radioisotope used here is 18FDG, 18-fluorodeoxyglucose, 18-fluorodeoxyglucose, glucose, 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 which has got a half-life of 110 to 120 minutes. What happens? We give this isotope in the peripheral vein, and this is glucose. This will be taken by the actively dividing cells in the body, the mitotic cells in the body. So anywhere if there is cancer in the body, the mitotic cells will immediately take up this glucose and they will appear as these golden shadows on whole body CT scan. So if you carefully take a look, this is a case of esophageal cancer, plus a lymph node nearby, plus there is a lymph node in a distant area as well. If there would have been lung metastasis, suppose, then these lung metastasis would have been seen as golden shadows, something like this, on this PET scan, right? If there would have been metastasis inside the liver, then these liver metastases would have been seen something like this, and that is how this PET scan can tell you about the distant metastasis. So investigation of choice for distant metastasis for majority of malignancies would be this PET scan. Very commonly asked, the isotope used in PET, it is the 18-fluorodeoxyglucose. The half-life is 110 to 120 minutes, bhoolna nahi hai isko. Very commonly asked in the MCQs. Now, when we have to do the treatment for esophageal cancer, the options which we have, once we have done the staging, basically with these investigations like the endoscopic biopsy, the endoscopic ultrasound, the CECT, the PET CT, you come to know how far the cancer has spread, and we can do the staging for esophageal cancer. TNM staging is the standard staging, T1 submucosa, T2 muscle, T3 adventitia, and T4 peri-esophageal structures. N for regional lymph nodes, M for distant metastasis. T1 submucosa, T2 muscle, T3 adventitia, and T4 peri-esophageal tissues. Ek bar boliye mere saath, please revise with me. You have to speak out from your vocal cords. T1 submucosa, T2 muscle, T3 adventitia, T4 adjacent organs, right? So that is how we can stage this esophageal cancer. And then we have to do the treatment. The treatment options for any malignancy, the three standard: surgery, chemo, radio. Surgery is the best treatment for esophageal cancer. For any malignancy like here, if we are talking about surgery, then we have to remove this cancer along with a margin. Why margin? Because we don't want to leave any residual cancer cell behind, right? So margin of resection for esophageal cancer to be taken, proximal 10 and distal 5. Since proximal 10 and distal 5, that means 15 centimeters is the margin. If the tumor is say 8 centimeters, then 10 plus 8 plus 5, that is 23, and the length of esophagus is 25. So majority of the times what we have to do is we land up in doing a total esophagectomy. Like here, and you can see we have removed the esophagus completely. And once we have removed the esophagus, the best substitute to make the new esophagus is the stomach. So what we can do is, we can just make a tube of the stomach and do this reconstruction. So total esophagectomy with esophageal reconstruction, generally by a thoracic approach, Ivor-Lewis operation is the commonest thing done for esophageal cancer. Most common early complication is an anastomotic leak. This area can leak, and that can lead to pulmonary complications. In late stages, there can be stricture formation here. So this is all about the esophageal discussion. Thank you very much for your patience. Now what we are going to do is, we are going to break the stream here, and we'll be going ahead with the next video for the stomach after 10 minutes. So we'll be taking a break here of 10 minutes, and then we'll be starting the discussion of stomach and duodenum. I hope the esophagus is revised nicely with you. Let us take a look at the pictures once again quickly, so that you don't take much time in revising the esophagus. We discussed about the basic anatomy of the esophagus. Then we discussed about the congenital problems, the esophageal atresia and the dysphagia leucorrhea. Then we discussed about the trauma section, the different foreign bodies inside the esophagus, the esophageal perforation associated with endoscopy, which was the commonest perforation. Then we discussed about the pressure perforation, that is a Bor-Havi syndrome, spontaneous esophageal rupture or barotrauma that was seen because of forceful vomiting, right? And the site of rupture in Bor-Havi was lower esophagus, but the commonest site of esophageal perforation is upper esophagus near the cricopharynx. Then we discussed about ecclesia cardia. Then we discussed about this diffuse esophageal spasm, something like this. Then we discussed about Schatzky's ring. Then we discussed about GERD, the complications of GERD, the esophagitis. Then we discussed about the Barrett's esophagus. Then we discussed about the hiatus hernias. And then we discussed about the Zenker's diverticulum. In this Zenker's diverticulum, we discussed nicely, it is a false diverticulum through the Killian's dehiscence inferior constrictor cricopharynges. And then finally, we discussed about the esophageal cancer. So I hope, beta, in this 1 hour, we have discussed about this esophagus nicely. Thank you very much for your patience. May God bless you all. Wish you all the best. We'll be back soon within 10 minutes. Bye-bye.